Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some love. Don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some love here today.
Yeah. Episode number 4, speaking to the mic. Your humble and grateful and honored host, Michael Morning, with my partner, my main man, DeJuan Mooley Robinson, sitting on the side of me. And I've been blessed to receive my homeboy, my partner, Mr. Travis Stroud, as my first guest on episode number 4. And I want to thank all you guys out there for locking in, for listening, for checking us out, being a part of us, being a part of this journey. Speaking to the mic is just getting started. So we got today, before we get started though, I want to give a shout out to my son, Mr. Bo Morning, who will be 13 on Wednesday. Happy birthday, boy. You know it's time to tighten up, right? We coming in and we coming hard. 13, you a teenager. So all these guys sitting in here with me today, they about to start pulling your card. So get ready. Get ready, the show is coming. But no, thank you all. Thank you guys, everybody, for listening in, joining us again as we embark on Speaking to the Mic. And again, for all those that don't know, you know, Speaking to the Mic is here to educate and empower and enhance the mindset of our next generation. And in doing so, we're reaching out to a lot of our relationships and our networking within the community, people that's already doing great things. And we're going to start it off right here on episode number 4. Again, I got my main man, Travis Stroud, here with me. Home team from the Sports Talk Show, and we're going to have some conversations today, y'all. And so before we get started, though, I want to introduce my boy, Travis Stroud, so everybody can get to know him, get to know what he about, so you can understand the conversation we're going to have as we get into it today. So my main man, Dunwoody High School, I brought my Doug High shirt. Just in case he came up in this place looking crazy, y'all. So for all the Astros, the big, the bold, the black, and the gold, I got some Decatur cats in the house tonight. But we gonna treat him right, because he's my partner. He's been my partner for over 20 years.
I need you to start off with Gresham first, Decatur, before you just threw me up in Dunwoody waters.
But, well, I ain't want everybody to know you was on the M&M, but, you know, hell, he was one of them, y'all. And hey, it's okay.
That was my mama and them, if that's okay for me to say that.
That's okay, man. That's okay. So go ahead and introduce yourself, Travis, and kind of tell everybody about your journey and what you got going on. Father, husband, entrepreneur, competitor.
I'm an entrepreneur. You know, it's one of those things. I grew up in South DeKalb. I was on the M&M program. Started off, graduated from Gresham Park Elementary School when when elementary schools went to seventh grade. Then I jumped on the bus and headed up north to Peachtree, and then Peachtree ended up merging with Dunwoody, right? So that was a task as well, because Peachtree was on one side of the tracks, if you will, and then Dunwoody were on the other side of the tracks. So coming from South DeKalb, going to Peachtree, you try to find your way. And then they merged with Dunwoody, so they had their own problems. And from there, was a scholar athlete. I like to lead with that. I was a three-sport athlete. I won state wrestling championships, baseball championships.
Give it to them.
And state
Don't be humble.
Championships.
Give them the juice.
Was you know, ended up, you know, getting some accolades early. You know, I had some early success, which could be a gift and a curse. You know, ended up being, you know, Gatorade Player of the Year and All USA Today, Parade All-American, you name it.
He was interesting, y'all.
Yeah, I was blessed. You don't find too many baseball players that play defensive linemen as well. Believe it or not, the sport chose me. I didn't choose the sport.
Okay.
Because let me have it, I would have stayed at baseball. But,
really?
You know, it's just one of those things you have to allow. I tell young folk that all the time. You know, what your destiny is, it'll choose you, you know, versus you choosing it. Mm. Ended up going to the University of Georgia, majoring Terry College of Business. You know, always had aspirations of going to college. I knew my parents couldn't afford, you know, to send three boys to school. So my brother and I, we had to tap into some gifts that we had, because Proverbs 18:22 says a man's gifts makes room for him. So we tapped into that because we were able to perform on the field. We had some opportunities to engage in higher learning. First generation to go to school and graduate. My dad went to school. Unfortunately, he was drafted out of college to go to the military to serve in Vietnam. So ended up going to the University of Georgia. Everything was going well. I made the all-freshman SEC team. Then the injury bug hit, unfortunately. So my motivations had to change. So my thing was, I'm going to school. Yeah, I'm going to get this degree because that's what my dad said I needed to do. But wanted to go to the league. That was the ultimate goal, because I knew that would put me in a position to change the family's life. But when the injuries hit, I had to fall really back. I hate to say fall back. I had to rely on, you know, the scholarship part of it, the education part of it. So even though I still had an opportunity to go to the league, I had to really focus on the education part of it, right? So, you know, I tell young folk, identify what you're good at, you know, your ability, your motivation, and then your attitude. So that was one of the things. I identified what I was good at, which was playing a sport and being scholarly, right? Being a student athlete. My motivations, it was really, I wanted to go to school for free. So we tapped into that, got to school, got some injuries. So I had to fall back and, you know, on the education piece, and still was able to go on. And, you know, I was picked up as a free agent, you know, with the Falcons, and dabbled in the league for a minute, played in the Arena League for a minute. But I decided to retire myself. But believe it or not, I wanted to use the money that I earned from playing that sport to invest in the community, to build business. So when that sport was taken away, I still had the aspirations of doing that. Then you find me 20 years later, you know, doing film and TV, sports choreography, starting the Game Breaker Corporation, you know, that's apparel. You know, training athletes, to starting an IT company, you know, as human capital and management consultant. And that's, you know, consulting with C-level management, you know, helping them build teams depending on their initiatives. Hard to find people like data architects, right? Developers, getting insight on what companies are looking to do IT or systems, information systems wise, and I help them come up with a solution, and then I'll, you know, find the people to do the work for them. Been fortunate. I worked on the Brian Banks project last year as a marketing consultant. If you hadn't seen that movie, go check it out. It's on iTunes. It changed my life because I had a chance to travel around with the guy that was wrongfully accused of rape, and he was later vindicated, but he lost 11 years of his life. So you look at, you know, athletics is a vehicle. It's a way of expression. It doesn't define who we are. You know, 0.08% of athletes transition from one phase of their lives over into the professional ranks, but 98.02% have to go into a profession based on their degrees. And then you look at Brian's situation with circumstance, mine was injury. So all of that goes into that 0.08% that you think about. So if you was a betting man, what you betting on, 0.08% or 98.02% as far as how you make your decision? So Been blessed, man. It's been hard, you know, being an entrepreneur. It sounds sexy because Atlanta is the home of the $30,000 millionaire. You know, shout out to everybody who bosses who ain't making but $30,000, but it's all good.
Boss.
Yeah, bosses, right? But it's a grind, man.
No doubt.
At the end of the day. I know that was a long introduction. Y'all wouldn't count on that.
No, man.
But y'all mess around and put a mic in front of me, man. It's over with.
No, you good, man. You good. And I can't leave our home team, Brandon Leak, also from the A, and Morehouse Man. So, you know, if you don't mind, Brandon, kind of walking us through, you know, a little journey that you got yourself.
It was the same as Travis.
No doubt. Because they were pretty long.
Same it's path, similar same yeah, to yeah. Travis. Okay. Yeah, we all here together. We made it today.
Yeah.
Native of Decatur, Georgia. Grew up in Decatur. Played sports at Glenwood Hills, at the Glenwood Hills Athletic Association. So we had a couple of battles with the Gresham Park Rattlers.
Yeah, shout out to Gresham.
Growing up, shout out to Glenwood Hills and the Panthers. Ended up going to Dunwoody High School. I was on that M2M program. Mama said, you gonna put on your best when you go. And
they wanted bad.
We were mad. I was mad. All my friends went to Columbia High School, so yeah. I was mad that I had to go to Columbia, get on the bus, and go to Dunwoody. But turned out, made some great friends, some lifelong friends, and it changed my life. Ended up finishing high school and didn't want to go to college right after high school. So ended up working for the United States Postal Service for 3.5 years. Met some fantastic people, some lifelong friends, learned about the United States government and how things work and how they should be working. And then after I did that, I said, you know what, I'm ready to go to school, and got the great fortune to walk the halls of Morehouse College. My daddy got a chance to go, and he told me for many years, I don't care where you're going, boy, but my money's going to Morehouse.
How about that?
So I was glad that I didn't waste his money going right after high school, because I would not have been as focused. And one thing led to another. Ended up working at what now is Wells Fargo, used to be Wachovia Bank. They had a great tuition reimbursement program. Go to school in the daytime, go to work at night, you make A's and B's, they pay for your school. They pay for all the credit hours you're taking if you made A's and B's. So that's where I started to make the transition, because when I was doing that, for my lunch break, I would listen to a sports talk station that I ended up working for on my lunch break every day. And I ended up getting my break in radio. Doing that. I've been working in radio for the last 20 years. Luckiest guy in the world. I got a chance to travel the world, boxing matches, call football games, been to SEC championship games, been to bowl games, been a color analyst, been a play-by-play announcer, and all of that came because I got a fantastic opportunity interning at a radio station. And one day when I was on my quick story how I got in, one day I was on my lunch break, and somebody who was filling in one of the shows I listen to every day started bad-mouthing the Braves, talking about the Braves, wasn't this and that. And I had enough. So I picked up the phone and said, hey, man, that's the problem with radio here. We don't have people from here that are for the teams here, and you right now are part of the problem. What we need is somebody, one, who knows what they're talking about, and two, cares about the team.
Get them out of there.
And the guy says to me, well, if you think you can do better, why don't you come down here? I'll be there.
No doubt.
Didn't know what I was doing. I think we ended up being really good friends, Mitch Evans. I think his plan was to kind of embarrass me. He's going to have me do a sports update live on the air, just throw it to me. But I listened to the show every day. Yeah. I knew when they went to break. Mm-hmm. I knew how long a sports update was supposed to be. So when he handed me the paper, all right, big time, you go. Music starts playing. Atlanta Braves beat the Mets 4-3. I saw Chipper Jones drive in two runs with a two-out double in the ninth inning. I ended up rocking the update. Then when I got to the end, and I said, and this is home, I wasn't home team at the time. I said, this is Brandon Lee filling in for this sucker, Mitch Evans, here on 790 The Zone. And everybody fell out, and then I got to stick around. And then when I got done, I asked them about interning.
Okay.
And they said, yes, you can intern. So I got to use my sports connections while I was at school to write for the Maroon Tiger.
Right.
Use some of those connections to start getting interviews. One thing led to another, and I'm here with all you fine people 20 years later.
I never knew that, man. That's what's up.
Yeah, it was. I'm a lucky dude. So
you see the kind of stuff I pull out. See the kind of stuff I pull out, and that's what we're here for, though. I mean, that's what speaking to the mic is here to do.
Yeah.
To really to give back to the community, show that we can build relationships and use our relationships for networking opportunities to show our youth what it means to partner with people and not just try to compete against yourself all the time. So, you know, one of the hottest topics we got out right now, that's why I wanted you guys to pull up, and I'm glad y'all were gracious enough to pull up for us, is this football we got going on. We got schools starting back up, And they trying to push our babies to go play some football. So, you know, what you guys think about that?
Mike, do you have a seatbelt? Can I strap myself in? Because Trav and I were talking about this morning. I'm about to strap myself in.
Hey, man.
I'm with you. I already know how I feel. They're our children, our babies, and coronavirus, COVID-19, is impacting the black community differently than it is other communities. So I don't think you could take a broad brush and paint everything the same, but you do have to look at the data and the facts. And if the facts are the black community suffers differently, and there are two things that I can't get people to answer yes to me. One, would you want to be sitting next to somebody who you know had coronavirus, number one? And number two, can you tell me what the long-term effects of coronavirus are? I can't get anybody to say yes to both of those. It's a problem. So I don't have children. I have godchildren. If I had children, I would have some extreme concerns sending kids into an environment, not just where it's not necessarily controllable, but the fact that everybody doesn't view coronavirus and the protocols the same as what the other kids are doing at their families and what their families are doing in their off time to kind of quarantine or do what's best for their small communities and the pockets they're in to bring it towards my family. So I think it's something that really needs to be looked at. And ultimately, if we can't have football for 1 year, then that's what we need to do is if it's the best decision for our children to be safe.
Yeah, you mentioned data.
Oh, boy.
Like, who verified the data?
Okay.
Because, I mean, right before the show started, one of the experts said that kids should be going back to school in person.
Why?
I have no idea.
He said because there are negative impacts to kids not going to school.
Well, it's
the social impact. Kids need social interaction. They also need in-face instruction. The truth is the kids aren't learning anything when they come home.
Yeah.
What we're finding out is our teachers need a lot more money and a lot more respect.
No doubt.
With these kids coming home now, and they're basically just doing work and just passing time along. They're not being taught. So there is a reason for kids to be in school, but we have something out there that can make them sick and could potentially harm them forever.
But they are being taught. You know, those teachers that, those parents that thought the teachers were, weren't up to par and up to the task, they realized it wasn't the teacher. It was the kids at the end of the day.
That's true.
They need these outlets. Do I think young folk should play? Yeah, we have to figure out how to streamline
that. Question.
Yeah, we have to figure out the best way. I mean, the basketball folk, they figured it out, the bubble. You know, scenario, right? They pretty much got the answer to the test. We hadn't heard any repercussions for that, except for the dude that went to the funeral and then stopped off at
Lou Williams
Magic City to get something to eat. So I don't know how he'll, you know, infect the bubble. But just think, man, an idle mind is a devil's playground, right? And you got kids counting on this opportunity to transcend their current scenario. Right? So we need something organized that they can associate with that we can continue to feed positive reinforcement into these kids. Now, is it safe? No. I mean, us getting in the car driving up the street isn't safe, right? It's not necessarily safe for us to, I don't know who, you know, those that drink and drive or, you know, do whatever they do. But at the end of the day, there is a need on this level, the high school level, but those commodities in the NFL, I think, you know, is a commodity that can make a decision, that can truly decide and stand up and show their worth as a product. Now, they can step back. A lot of people look at athletes not as regular employees. They are because they get paid a king's ransom for a child game, right? But if you're at the meat packing place and it's an outbreak, you don't expect those guys to go to work, right? But
right.
We need to figure out something for these kids to do that will allow them to have that outlet to play this sport.
Well, I think the problem too is that we're trying to compare, or we're trying to let the professional athletes and what they have going on drive what's happening down the line.
Exactly.
That's
to
right.
College, to high school, and park.
Yeah.
You know, we got people watching what's happening professionally and assuming that we're in that same world when the money is totally opposite.
It's totally opposite.
But you got parents out there, you know, who been pushing their kids to do A, B, and C, going to these practices and 7-on-7s and different things like that. So they're expecting their kids to go out there and perform because they've invested time, they've invested money, and they're still painting that picture as, and they're making decisions based on professional athletes.
Yeah.
And I think that's a problem what we're having in our community outside of not understanding the resources that those professional teams have.
I think you're absolutely right. And I think that you need to understand that there's a clear delineation. The pro athletes work in concert with the owners. They have a union. The union agrees with management what the rules are. High school kids do what they're told to do. College kids do what they're told to do. There is no union. They really don't have anybody looking out for them except for the people who benefit from them being on the field. So you're absolutely right. The pros, whether they play, they have an option to opt out in the NFL if you want to and still get paid. Why? Because they negotiated that as a professional athlete. Or they could play and get their full salary, which is a decision they could still make as a professional athlete. College kids, high school kids don't have those same protections. They don't have any unions. They don't get paid for what they do. And so what they have to do is risk their body and their health in order to get the chance to be the professional athlete. And I think that's something we need to take a look at, because I don't think 1 year off taking sports, my opinion, is worth risking the death of any child. If I think the problem that I'm having with this whole COVID thing is people saying, well, it's 3%, it's 2%, it's 1%, whatever it is. It's somebody that don't have to die. And I guess because I know people who have personally been impacted by COVID, and I know three people who have died from it, so I know more than 3% that dies. And I would certainly like to tell you that their families don't care about what the data says about who's dying. They don't want their family members to have it. I don't want it. I don't want none of y'all to have it. And I don't want any of these kids to have it. So I think it's a tough decision, because sports is something that impacts the community immediately.
As a whole.
And it also impacts a lot of people who work in the sports.
I mean, morale, the whole nine, man. I mean, I think it's more control for young folk. Just like this weekend, my son played perfect game baseball. He stayed with us. We drop him off. He does his pregame. They play the game. They're socially distanced. After the game, we bring him home. Now, the guys in college, it's similar to the league, just because we do get taken care of, you know, in those top five, top five schools like Georgia, Notre Dame, Texas, right? And you take those people who are over you, their word for that they have your best interest. So you do what they say. So they can kind of corral you and keep you in that bubble. Once they go to training camp, I think they can kind of control the environment. Now, in the league, they got to figure out those who are married. Yeah, you test the family members, right? Those that aren't, you just identify two or three of them joints that you're dealing with. You know, get them tested consistently to where when they come into the environment, you know exactly where they're coming from. But, you know, as a whole, I think it shouldn't be hard, because it is a matter of life and death. But based on the traction that we're starting to get with breaking the walls down of this systemic scenario, unfortunately, some nationalities are affected more than others, and you know, just calling it like it is, we're affected more than others,
right?
I'm you know, God rest his soul, I know Herman Cain wish he probably wouldn't have gone out to Tulsa, right?
Because or gone in socially distance and social, put a mask
well
on.
I mean, put a mask on, you taking pictures, you thinking we can do what other folk do, and we've never been in the position to do what other folk do, unfortunately.
And I think the other thing, Mike, I see is, unfortunately, sometimes you just have to look and see what's going on. The only thing that looks like it's working right now is the bubble life.
Basketball,
where
yeah.
WNBA, NBA, and MLS are completely quarantined from, everybody else. They test every day and they make people wear masks. They're totally separated. Or a sport like golf, where you aren't around people. When you're talking about playing football, you have to be around people. You have to travel. You have to get on a bus. If you're in college, you have to get on a plane and fly from state to state. It just doesn't seem like football is set up to have the same protections as some of the other sports. So unless they can find a way to put these kids, these young people in a bubble, I would not be for it, because I think it's not right and it's not fair to gamble with the lives of young people so we can play a game that is essential down the road for some, but not essential for everybody right now.
And I know a scenario. I had a conversation. One of the coaches with the Jets. He said he's tested every day. He goes into the office. So Monday, he get the results. Tuesday, he tests Tuesday. When he go in Wednesday, he get the results, you know, from Tuesday's test. So they have a process. Now, it becomes, like, exponentially expensive, right?
Yes.
So we got to figure out how to balance out some of this expense with some revenues. And you, product, we need y'all to get out there and perform, right? I don't want to say ownership, they own you or what have you, but I think baseball, because they got those guaranteed contracts, they kind of got the attitude, like, I can do what I want to do. I got this money. And a lot of people tend to throw money at their problems when that's not necessarily the case, right? But you have a lot of athletes that the deadline is Thursday before they're able to opt out. But I don't know what the repercussion is for those that don't opt out, that opt out after the deadline. You know, what comes with that?
Well, you mentioned contracts. So in even thinking about contracts and just all of the sports that we got going on, what about those rookies, you know, who don't even get a paycheck until that first whistle is blown?
Those agents that represented, paid for the combine training, they hadn't gotten paid off for housing those kids and putting those expenses up. So you got a lot of people waiting right now, not just for the stimulus check, but just real payments, money that they work for. Yeah, they work for that.
And it's not just athletes. You know, there's a lot of people behind the scenes who, like you mentioned, the agents, the business managers. You know, it's a lot of people behind the scenes who are missing out on paychecks too.
Yeah.
But when we think about those guys out there, because I just heard that Odell Beckham, you know, he made a comment about he think that NFL should just shut down. You know, it's easy for a guy like Odell to say that.
He's got a lot of money.
It's because he's already got a lot of money. But those kids who just graduated from Georgia, who just got drafted, And other places, you know, who've been waiting on that first paycheck because it was already behind because they had no practices.
Yeah.
They ain't been able to show up and get no workouts in.
Yeah.
So they owe
agent. This is what I do know. You live according to your means. If you make $1 million a year, your expenses are $1 million a year. So you can't afford to miss no checks. I don't care who you are.
Right. You get $1 million check, you probably have $1 million worth of bills.
Worth of bills.
$1 million worth of electricity,
yeah,
water, mortgage,
and that's
car.
Why I said what I said about them not being looked at as regular employees. They're employees just like the average person out here in the street that may have a 3-month rainy day or a 6-month rainy day, but you start pinching off of it, you're looking for something to supplement, you know, that. So for him to make that statement is huge, because who knows? You know, I don't know how Odell is with his money, but if he's anything like his personality is, I'm sure he out there in them streets, you know, doing his thing.
My question is, why can't we just be smart? That's the one thing I'm learning about all this. We're not being as smart as we need to.
Right.
Why do we have to have everything the way it's always been? We can't do that. This is something unprecedented.
It's different. We've never seen
it. Why can't we play football in February, in March?
Well, I mean,
it's hard on the body.
Well, I mean,
why
being
can't we
hard
wait?
On the body, it's just a change.
Yes.
And nobody wants change, man. We're resistant to change in everything we do, you know. And it's as small as our favorite fast food spot.
Yeah.
If they come up with different work hours, we're going to feel indifferent.
We're going
to,
yeah.
You know, if we coming home and we used to getting a certain meal on Fridays, fish on Fridays, and you mess around and say, I want to make you a cheeseburger or some wings, I'm feeling indifferent because you made that decision without me.
Yeah.
Nobody wants change, man. We gotta get to a point where we have those conversations with the community and with parents about understanding, like, at this point you got to embrace the change.
And how about sacrifice too, Mike? Because to me, what sacrifice means is you doing something you don't wanna do so you can do something you wanna do. Sacrifice is not having something right now you want to have, so eventually you can have something you really want to have. So if we really want sports, we really want football, isn't the best thing to do to keep people away from each other until these things kind of settle down? That's the one thing we saw when everybody was sheltered in place. The numbers went down, and then see what can happen in a few months. You can play football when it's colder. I mean, half the time, I think people would rather play when it's cold than when it's hot anyway. So why can't we just wait a few months, put the kids out there when maybe it's not as dangerous, and maybe we have some better protocols in place? That's what I would be for.
But it throws off the future. Right?
Certainly.
Because you need
certainly
recovery time. To have a season this spring and then have a short layoff and then you start training camp late summer, that's a lot of wear and tear on the body. And I think a lot of us, we're goal-oriented people. I mean, humans are. We set goals. We want to go accomplish those goals. We put the work in. We want to see a result, right? And right. I mentioned early levels of success can be a gift and a curse. A lot of us set those goals, and we still have a burning desire for falling short the previous year. And we want to set some of that in place. So you got a lot of folk, whether it be owners, whether it be, you know, employees, whether it be players, that have mixed feelings about it because it's more of a one of those what have you done for me lately types of scenarios. And if I don't play and we delay this, they'll forget about me. You know, I may get older. You can call it what you want, man. A year old is a year older.
Right.
You know, joints and bones, they aren't as elastic, you know, if that's a word, you know, excuse that. It's a word now.
But no, I get
like bling, you know. Yeah. So, but no, it's serious because, you know, a year older, man, you don't know how the body responds, from the layoff.
And you know, the thing that I think that's kind of bothering me is when I see it, because I understand the competitive nature of sports.
Yeah.
And it's really next man up.
Absolutely.
So right. That those one goals, year absolutely. Can make a difference in your competitive advantage and what value you brought to that team, or if you even had a chance to bring it value to that team. Because if you come out there and you thinking you the next man up based on the roster, and you don't have a season, but you got another guy coming in there who running a 4-3.
And you got guys waited all of their lives
for this opportunity
to change their family's lives. It ain't just about that one person.
Let me ask a curveball question. Should we be putting this much emphasis on sports? You're right. There are people who put their entire lives and entire focus into this. But I look around this room and I see 4 black men, 5 black men, black woman, successful people who didn't play professional football and didn't make millions of dollars. So maybe there are other examples we should be teaching our kids. But the best thing we should teach them is you can't do none of it if you're not alive, right. If you're not healthy. And my concern is when I ask the question, since nobody can tell us what the long-term effects are, if you do become a professional athlete, there are people that are still talking about they can't breathe. They can't taste their food. How is that going to impact you when you're 25, 27, 28, supposed to be in your prime of your career? We don't know that, so we don't want you having that. So maybe the curveball question is, this year, maybe we need to focus on something else, because you're right. It does mess up the timeline, but the timeline for this whole country and this whole world has been messed up right now till we figure out if we're going to get a vaccine.
It's entertainment. If you go back and look at history, 1929, during the Great Depression, what was the number one industry coming out of the Great Depression?
Entertainment. Hollywood.
It was entertainment. People need an escape, and this is their escape. A lot of times, I remember playing at the University of Georgia, and, you know, alumni used to, you know, walk up to me, man, just for, you know, 2 hours, you've allowed me to escape my regular life for 3 hours, me cheering for you, it means the world. And then being able to have a conversation with us after the fact. So a lot of times, a lot of people are looking for an escape, you know, virtual, you know, learning, you know, staying home. You know, for my family, it's cool. You know, I'm fortunate I work from home. My wife, she's been able to work from home. We have 2 kids that we have to stay on. I can't imagine those who count on that that breakfast in the morning, that count on that lunch.
That's true.
In the morning, that they're waiting for the next day. They don't have a dinner, right? They don't have the best living arrangements. You know, we have sanctuaries for our kids to enjoy, you know, regular life. And a lot of kids look forward to going to school to get away from that pain and anguish that they have.
But that bespeaks a bigger problem. If your kids can't eat unless they go to school, we got to figure out how we can get some kids to eat. Right. Our monies are not focused right. Kids should be able to eat whether they have school or they don't have school. We don't have school right now, so they need to eat.
How we pulled $2.5 trillion out twice.
There you go.
Right? And we got people have to step over on a day-to-day basis. Those are questions. Those are the systemic questions and answers hopefully we can come up with by going through this pandemic. See, a lot of people say it to correct itself. Man, I've never seen anything like this.
Well, that's when we got to really get into the community, though.
Yeah.
You know, because, again, sports has been driving our mindsets all our lives.
Yeah.
You know, that gets the family out.
Right.
That gets all your friends out. You know, that's motivating for our community.
And the discipline that I have, I learned, of course, I was fortunate to have a pops that I grew up with. I had for 42 years of my life. However, I was able to learn a lot more based on character, what I'm made of, right? How to push myself, right? We tend to put our kids, ourselves in those situations so we can learn who we are, right? You want to find out who you are, you need to lose yourself first. And those sports allow you to lose yourself. Because a lot of times, you know, the great Mike Tyson said, well, everybody got a plan until they get hit in the mouth, right?
No doubt.
And those sports push you in a position to where you hit in the mouth, and then you got to learn how to pivot, right?
So right now, that's the problem, though.
Yeah.
There is no pivot.
Yeah. People are having a problem finding what to pivot to.
There is no pivot because all we know is sports. All we know a lot of in our community is sports, man. And it has gotten so ridiculous is that when you see some of these coaches, and I don't knock it because I love me some sports.
Yeah.
I love it. But it burns me up when I see these coaches really out there driving and running a play based on their check.
Absolutely.
You know, they out here training and doing these other things because they got to eat.
Yeah.
You know, it's an end game to it, but most parents don't know that.
Yeah.
Most parents still like, okay, we've been taking you over here every Saturday. We've been taking you up to East Cobb to do whatever, you know, throughout the week. A lot of our community hasn't really embraced what's really taking place right now because we're not pivoting. There is no change. We still moving just like we was moving before the pandemic.
We need to make
and that's what's not reality.
And that goes to show data, right? Our president, he's a real estate mogul. So work from home can kill somebody whose work a wealth is built on people coming in and paying you rent for the building, right? A lot of companies are saving a lot on their bottom line because they don't have to pay rent. So when you say data, I don't know if it's skewed, how real it is, because of the motivation, right? Once you understand somebody's motivation or why they do what they do, then you can kind of figure out how to move and how to engage. But, you know, when you look at the data, I don't know, Bill Gates, one of the most brilliant guys in the world, created software that runs a machine, right? And then you let all of that go, now you're in the vaccine business. That don't make sense to me, right? Now, are you in the vaccine business or are you in the licensing business? Because you want to be the first one to get to the moon, like, you know, like United States and Russia when they was trying to race to get to the moon. They didn't care who they killed, what they did to the atmosphere, they just wanted to be the first one. And he partnered with Dr. Fauci, and then you got, you know, other folk talking about, you know, different scenarios on, you know, data, right? I just don't know what to believe and how to believe it, right? Because I feel that those who are in that space, it's kind of like watching film, going back to athletics, small microcosm of life. When we watching film, we game planning for what may happen. And if you're in that space, whether you're at the CDC or the World Health Organization, you need to run different scenarios. People telling you that it's possible that a pandemic can happen. They was talking about this since 2014, 15. I know it's big, I know it's a huge landscape. However, we should have had somebody coming up with running different scenarios. That's the whole thing about data analytics. If this happened, this happened. As a developer, when I wrote programs, I had to write if-then statements. If this happens, or if this person clicked this, this needs to happen. If they don't input this, you know, checkbox, this right here, you need to get this error. So my thing is, when you mention data, it's just hard for me to kind of fathom because you can look at several different news outlets and everybody talking different stuff.
Well, we should all be, as human beings, critical of what we hear and then go verify and fact check.
Yeah.
I think the issue that I'm seeing is people want to hear the data that they want to hear.
Yeah.
Period.
They want to hear the numbers that prove their point.
Yeah.
And right. You know, I didn't know of Dr. Fauci until COVID-19. It's not something he
got can't throw.
On,
I know he can't
he's
throw.
He's been advising presidents since the AIDS epidemic in the 80s, since Ebola, since bird flu, since West Nile virus, and now COVID-19. He's always been doing this.
He don't give me comedy because we lost a lot of folk during the AIDS epidemic.
Now, all of a sudden, everybody wants to question what his motives are.
Yeah.
And his motives are to give the best information that he can. I'm not telling whether you should or you shouldn't. You need to go verify what he's talking
Absolutely.
About, what the CDC and the World Health Organization is talking about.
I get it.
You know, yourself. But that's an easy thing to do. What I'm seeing is I think what we're going through is people just want to hear, and it's just not with COVID, not with coaching or sports, just in general. We want to hear what we want to hear. Right. And sometimes you got to hear some things you don't want to hear. And I make it akin to folks who live in hurricane areas where they keep telling you a hurricane is coming. They keep telling you a hurricane is coming. This one might be bad, or, you know, knock out some windows. Keep hurricane. But every time the hurricane keeps telling you, they keep telling you it's coming, you don't leave. You stay. We're going to ride this one out. And then the big one comes, and then we're kind of in trouble together. And that's what I make this akin to. We don't want to hear the weather's just going to blow over,
but the weather,
and we'll be working next month. We want to hear that everything will be just fine. And the hurricane and the storm might last longer,
yeah,
and the power might be out a little bit longer than we want it to be.
Well, the weatherman, you know, I lose confidence during the summertime on the weatherman because they only write 2 out of 10 times. You know, most of the time, and they still keep their job and make a lot of money, man. I don't get it. How they able to do that?
Well, they don't send them to Vegas for poker games. They don't use the weatherman for the poker games. You're right about that.
But what it still boils down to, y'all, is just that we don't want to be uncomfortable, man.
Right.
We don't want that pressure. We don't want to make no executive decisions. We want it all to be just peaches and cream, man.
Yeah.
We don't want that pressure, and parents don't want that pressure. They want to just follow that same routine that they've been doing since before the pandemic.
We're creatures of habit.
They don't want to disappoint the kids and say, no, you can't go to practice. You know, they don't want to be that parent. But we got to understand what we're in. This is a new day, man. We can't keep operating as if nothing hasn't changed.
Yeah.
You know, if it is false, we hope they change it fast. But right now, you got parents and communities who actually have decision rights for kids not making decisions, man.
Yeah.
They not bossing up, as we say.
I can't remember who gave the quote, some people would rather have and believe a beautiful lie than the ugly truth.
Right.
And that's what we got to get out of. We have to accept what the truth is. I understand Travis's point about being skeptical and critical, and you certainly don't want to overreact when you hear things, and you have to make decisions about your family, about your money, about your savings, about your job, people who are losing their jobs and being furloughed. There's some real stuff going on. So you don't want to make rash decisions, but you also have to accept that if things aren't the way that you want them to be, as you say, you're going to have to pivot, and there are some changes that we all are going to have to make, and we can't look at it from a micro box of just this is what I do and this is how I'm. But we all are impacted, and everything that happens to, I think that's another thing we're not accepting. We're all interconnected to one another now, the right way that this world and this country is set
well
up.
We've always had to comply, and I'm talking about black folk. You know, people say minorities. I call it like it is. You know, black folk, we've always had to comply, and we always try to do things the right way, regardless on how it's painted on the television, right? And you have other folk that aren't used to having to comply. They're used to doing what they want to because of privilege, right? We're able to say that out in public now because, shoot, Jake Fromm, I met him, good dude. He said, well, we've been saying for years, you know, privilege. We need to make this higher so, you know, we could be the people of privilege that can afford this. We've always, you know, made that. And I'm, you know, I represent the University of Georgia to the highest esteem, but it was said. And you can't erase what it was said. I'm sure it was a mistake. He probably had, you know, meant it as a joke. But people have been telling us we was crazy for years for saying that it's an invisible system that's holding us from, you know, we can't breathe. It's a knee on our neck, right? We've been saying it for 400 years, what, 300 years, and then we went through it another 100 years, you know, at the end of the day.
You mentioned that invisible system.
Yeah.
So I've been thinking about this baseball thing as well. I don't see no African Americans in baseball. Is that an invisible system right now? Got the mask on?
You see black Latinos and, you know, Hispanics, but it's not a lot of black homegrown.
It's down to 6-7% now.
Yeah, 6-7%.
And
not even counting coaches. So, you know, football get a bad reputation for not being diverse. Basketball, I think, once again, they're getting it right. You know, they get former players that have a desire. They put them in that position. Most of the team is a reflection of the leadership. And, you know, they move accordingly. But baseball, and I recently got back engaged in baseball, and I'm trying to figure out how to navigate this system, you know, with my son. It's an organization. South DeKalb Tribe right now, they're trying to create a system for to get black kids back into baseball. But everywhere we go, we have to travel over an hour and a half just to play at 8 o'clock in the morning. So when our kids get to the ballpark, they got to wake up, they got to stretch before they even warm up, because there's no baseball in the city, right? We play baseball in the city. We would love for you to come down south, but a lot of times they say, well, they breaking the cars down there. We can't have tournaments, but at the end of the day, with the right security, you can do whatever you want to do, right? Because they've come to Little Vietnam and Kirkwood, and they changed the whole landscape over there. So you can always do what you put your mind to do when you see something you want and you want to change it. But yeah, man, baseball is one of those sports that should definitely be talked about as it relates to diversity.
And I don't, you don't want to cast with a broad brush, but the truth is, daddies usually play baseball with their sons. Mm-hmm. You can drop your kid off at a basketball practice or at a football field, and then the coaches, everybody takes over. You usually play catch and learn your first fundamentals of the game with your dads. And yep. Jimmy Rollins and Ryan Howard, when they played with the Phillies, talked about this, that it was hurting their heart that they didn't see African Americans playing the game to the same degrees as other sports. Right. And they both came to the same conclusion that it's just not something you see where kids are playing with their dads at an early age. And so we need more of that. We need to support these coaches that are riding around picking these kids up and changing their hours at work trying to teach kids how to play basketball. Those are the guys that need our support, because you do what you see. And if you see it early and you get taught right early, maybe we can see the numbers in high school, in the minor leagues, and in college start to go up, so we can see the numbers of African Americans in baseball at the major league level go up too.
And what happens is they can be developed, like home team just mentioned, but as soon as they reach a certain level of success, somebody comes and poaches, right? And then that talent becomes managed, right? Because you don't want to have to compete against that. You want that on your team, right? So you can develop a kid, and then you tell a parent who may be struggling to pay those fees, because baseball is expensive, like playing golf. It's not.
I didn't know that. How much y'all pay? I had one wooden bat.
A young lady told me.
Goodness.
We paid between $15,000 and $2,000.
Good.
Down here in the hood. East Cobb is $4,000. Young lady told me she paid $4,000 this summer to play baseball, right? And you got to tell me, you got to show me a line item by item on what am I receiving for this $4,000. Is it just tournaments? We showing up, hitting a few balls in the cage? No, I need you to be able to mentor my kid, develop my kid, bring some scouts in. You got to paint a picture on the career development for me to give you $4,000 a year, right? But at the end of the day, our community, we listen to what somebody says. You need to play up there because they got all the relationship with the coaches and the scouts, so you need to be. But we're playing in the same tournaments. We're playing the same people that you saying, I'm going to show you something different, but we're running into the same people up at these parks, right? But what happens is those schools, those scouts will call that team, their coaches, hey, man, I got a catcher and a shortstop. I got a spot open. Who you think I should get? That's the upper hand, right? But at the end of the day, it's us. And I told the owner of the organization, South Dekalb Tribe, I said, well, you got to stop recruiting kids. You got to recruit the parents with the right paradigm that aligns with what it is you're trying to do. That way they won't waver, right? Because if you go at the kid and then you got this parent, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, and they show you these facilities and what you're able to get, they gonna pull little Johnny who you poured all of your time into.
Come
and
play coaches, with us.
These coaches ain't getting paid. A lot of folks ain't. They don't have the disposable income that these other communities have. They're paying their coaches. Our coaches are doing it on some love. Hopefully, they can get some grant money to provide it. But at the end of the day, man, that's definitely a diversity.
So where are we missing the mark as it relates to we having to drive to the East Cobbs and doing all that, but they are coaching our kids?
Yeah.
What are we not doing right?
They're managing your kids.
Okay.
And they're exposing them. And when I say exposing them, well, it was a tournament this weekend. Most of the black kids that were up at that tournament had one way or another played for this South Dekalb organization, right? But now they're paying for, the Smyrna team, they're playing the East Cobb, 6'4", 3 field generals, you name it. But you have you know, teams that come from, you know, Cascade that does really well. You got this Tribe team that does really well and develop those kids. You just have to figure out that we can build relationships, right? We have to figure out how to build the right relationships with those coaches. So what I've done, and this
so
is
so you're saying that the coaches in the city are not building relationships.
Well, they don't have the relationships because, you know, some of them may have gone HBCUs. You can't tell me Drew Charter.
What?
I'm going to give you an example. I'm like Drew Charter School, and I'm not knocking HBCUs, but
can't have that.
You had the number one
can't
golfer.
Have that.
Yeah.
Can't have that.
No, I'm just saying you had the number one golfer come out of Drew High School. He's going to North Carolina A&T, which could have very well been a choice of his, but he should have at least had, you know, a Stanford offer or a Duke offer to play at the D1 level, and then he make the decision to go to that A&T, not just have A&T, Howard. And I'm like I said, I'm not knocking it because I'm a PWI guy, right? However, I don't speak ill will because I'm trying to figure out an initiative to redirect more of our kids to the HBCUs.
How we can change.
I'm giving a scenario right now. We got to identify a school. All HBCUs need to be on the same page, right? Whether it's A&T. A&T got the most success right now besides Bethune-Cookman and FAM. We need to figure out how to get everybody on the same page. We need to get a coach in place with some prestige that we can get behind recruiting.
It comes down like
and
I
then
said,
we get with the boosters and identify a three-year plan on what we can afford to pay just a random person like Hines Ward to be the head coach at A&T. Then you can pipeline, you got prestige, you got affiliation. Now you can start pipelining that talent, you know, to those schools, because at the end of the day, what I've learned, some of my best friends went to HBCUs and they're thriving in business. I can't even get a return phone call from the University of Georgia.
And that's something.
And we bled, sweated, and teared for the University of Georgia.
That goes down to what you see. You do what you see.
Yeah.
So if you want more kids, in my opinion, to start going and taking the risk, we saw McCourt Maker, number one kid in the world. He went to Howard, and it was somebody said, hey, do you know about Howard University? Do you know who went here?
Yeah.
You know the history of the school? No, I do not.
Yeah.
Gave him the exposure. He liked what he saw.
Yeah.
He liked his experience. And now the best player in college basketball, who was only going to play 1 year anywhere he went, is now going to an HBCU. And so,
and what I was able to do, even for the baseball scenario this weekend, I invited one of the top baseball coaches in the, you know, state of Georgia. He's over at Wesleyan. I said, man, just come out and check out the squad, because one of his players come from the south side that go to the private school up north, and you know, he came out, you know, witnessed it, you know, so now you don't have to just refer the East Cobbs
or
the 643. You can refer some of these other
programs. It seems like after all these years it would be an easy win to just say, hey, I'm gonna chop this fee down in half, I'm gonna have all y'all come to say Cascade or some of these other community parks, and we gonna have a team and just run it like that. But I don't understand how
it's hard to corral and get folks who have
parents.
Their own agenda.
Okay.
You know, because they're thinking their kid will be the next.
Well, it's the perception
everything.
Of what they think they're
yeah,
gonna
what
get,
they
out
think
of
get out of East College.
That you're gonna automatically get a D1 scholarship. No, you won't.
Yeah.
If you can play baseball, you can play it in high school, and you can play
you
it
can
well,
play it anywhere.
And you're good. The cream always rises to the top. And I'm not knocking
right.
any of these people.
Right.
You know, it's a good thing and a good exposure. But I just think that the perception that if you're playing in some of these these leagues and these tournaments and you're paying these absorbent fees, puts you on a track to be a better or get you something that you really don't have in you.
Yeah.
I think that's somewhat of a mistake to put on kids and to put on parents as well.
And then you look at data once again. These programs up north, they'll tell you, yeah, we've had so-and-so kids to go to Vanderbilt and South Carolina. This person went, you know, 21st overall. But how many of those are African-American, right? Give me that number, right? You manage this talent that was being nurtured down south. Now you're managing them. Yeah, you're teaching them, giving them some, you know, some nuggets. But at the end of the day, are you able to press those buttons that he needs to be pressed when he dragging? That somebody else could probably get to him and make that happen. So, you know, at the end of the day, man, we just got to figure out just how to make it diverse, man. Just if it shouldn't all be an hour away for us in order for us to play the game of baseball.
We should not have to be doing that. As much talent as we have in any other sport and all everything else we have going on within the city, I don't understand it. But that's why we
It ain't no more Daryl Strawberry. It ain't no more Claudell Washington's. You know what I'm saying? It ain't no more Ozzie Smith's. You know,
but that's
because,
why we here though.
Yeah.
We gotta think process improvement. We gotta think really educating and empowering the community to the point where they like, you know how hard it is for me to pay $2,000 for this baseball league? But I really think my son can make it. I really think he can go get this scholarship.
Yeah,
I really
and that's all it's about.
He can get this guaranteed money at 16, 17 years of age.
You know how easy it was in life for me to come out of school not owing anybody anything? I could have gotten a $40,000, $50,000 a year job and been good. But imagine having $75,000 to $100,000 worth of debt that you can't bankrupt. Right, you can't get out from under it.
Barack just paid his student loans off a few years ago.
And he was president of the United States.
Right.
Come on,
so
man.
Good, so you're going down with it. So you're going down
so we
with
just
it.
Need free schooling, man. Ain't talking about that. Reparations, to me, it ain't cash money. If you want to pay reparations to black folk, man, help us out with some mortgage money. Let us go to school for free, right? That's all I ask. You know, a couple generations. Help us bridge the gap that way. It ain't got to be a monetary donation so we can go make Cadillac number one dealership. I just want to make sure that we can kind of get some opportunities that that hadn't been awarded. You know, my grandfather, his grandfather, my dad.
Taxes.
You know, yeah, let me keep my money.
Taxes.
Yeah.
Social Security.
Yeah.
Black man don't live as long as other people in America, so you know why you have to wait so long to get your retirement and your Social Security. Maybe use that money to invest while you're a little bit younger and do some things that might be able to help you start a business a little bit more.
Absolutely.
Or it's buy a house and sell
ways
it.
To make reparations make sense.
To make sense.
But
yeah.
Some of the things you hear is like, come on,
it ain't
man.
About the money.
You can't be silly now.
And that's what people are.
You can't be silly.
People are really silly because they're making these statements about reparations as if that's reality, and that's what's not reality.
You also got to know that certain words are going to be trigger words, even though they're not wrong. Reparations or defund. When you say those are trigger words.
Yeah.
So you need to make sure when you drop one of those words,
you're ready
you
to
come
defend.
In with your facts, and they're in order. Else, folks going to be throwing crazy
smoke
stuff.
Smoke coming.
Smoke coming all day long.
Smoke coming, man.
Fire. No, fire coming. It ain't smoke. Yeah, it's
F-I-E.
Yeah.
Fire.
Because, again, it goes back to how we've allowed society to define what we got going on.
Yeah.
Right? Society has defined a lot of the things that has triggered our whole thought process in the community.
Yeah.
How we moving, how we eating. You know, if society say it's wrong, we go to the left.
Yep.
If society say it's right, we go to the right. Society is driving what we got going on, and that's what we got to get out of, allowing society to define what's realistic for us and not. You know, you hear those words, you mentioned defunding, you know, but for the masses, people hear defunding, and they think it means immediately no more police officers or taking everything away from the police officers. They haven't really defined what that means, but the media pushes it so many different ways that it's a bunch of chaos.
So then you use reallocate.
Hey, and then they
reallocate the funds.
Yeah, reallocate.
Who could argue that?
Nobody.
Yeah, nobody.
So
nobody.
That's what I'm
it's
saying.
Simple.
Do you realize
we could
police
go the same way and keep saying it, keep saying it, and we're not wrong.
Yeah.
But if we're trying to get to the end game,
yeah.
Reallocate the funds. Who
but,
could
but
have a problem
nobody,
with that?
Why is nobody asking that though? Like you hear all these debates about that one particular
one word.
Is that
a
one word has driven so much chaos. And confused.
And you got police not showing up accidents.
That one word. But if you use, like you saying, change it to reallocate, it's a game changer.
It's a game changer.
Weaponize the English language.
Yeah, we got to do better, man. We got
to
do better.
And
overall.
We have to learn how to speak that king's language.
Yeah.
That's important.
That's how the laws are written.
Yeah. We have to learn how to interpret it.
That's how change happens, changing the laws.
Comprehend it and then be able to speak it as well, man. At the end of the day. And it's all love, man. It's me really using my platform, my existence, to uplift a people. And a lot of times that's muffled. And a lot of people don't want to empower that because I'm a selfless person. You know, everything I do is to empower other folk. Is it reciprocated? Oftentimes it's not. You know, I'm good. I can sleep at night. But at the end of the day, we have to figure out each other's motivation. Why we doing what we doing? A lot of people don't even understand why they doing what they doing. I just told you right now, we just want scholarship money, man. I just want my kids to go to school for free and not have to worry about paying an obligation. I don't use the D word because I believe what you put out in atmosphere, it comes back to you.
Well, we're going to get it right.
Yeah.
We're going to get it right, and that's why we got speaking to the mic.
That's right.
To get it right. We running some plays. We putting some people together. We putting some communities together, and we're going to make it happen. And before I go out on this show, I want to thank my guests. Episode number 4, you guys have showed up and showed out. Definitely kept us going. But I want to dedicate this show also to my pops. Today, a year ago, I lost my pops.
Oh, man.
And I love you, man. Wish you was here. I miss you. But your boy got it, and I'm going to hold us down. Love you. Speaking to the mic.
Amen.
Love you to the VOP, to all the followers, everybody who's viewing in. Stay connected. The journey. Ride the journey with us because it's going to be a long one. We just getting started. Episode 4, and we coming at you.
Absolutely. I have an IG, Real Travis Stroud. I'm working on Twitter. At Game Breaker.
Why was he so sexy with that?
You saw
it's like a sexy pastor is what he is.
Just because I was talking to somebody who, you know, who saw me on this podcast. You know, I was letting them know I see him. You know what I'm talking about? But Real Travis Stroud, you know, Instagram. At Game Breaker is my Twitter. And yeah, man, I'm. You can find me, you know, in the streets or on a commercial. You know, you just never know where you.
I knew it was some flag damn on pitch plane coming out.
Yeah,
I knew it was the end game.
Yeah,
for me, it's just a home team. B Leak at Twitter, Instagram. You can find me at Home Team Brandon Leak at Facebook. And you can listen 9 to noon Monday through Friday. The Home Team and Hamilton show on Extra 106.3 here in Atlanta. That's XTRA, and you can also follow that on Twitter as well.
No, that's
part of Joe Hamilton, the College Football Hall of Famer.
I got to work on my plug. So go to GameBreaker.net.
There
go
you
buy
go.
You some shirts. Go buy you a shirt.
And actually, since this is episode 4. Follow Speaking to the Mic on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, because we coming at you. I'm getting better. We getting better.
Yeah.
See you soon.
Amen.
Thank you.
You see me moving all the needed people out my life. And I'm trying to get these crazy thoughts out of my mind. Yeah, you gave me all the weapons, but it's still a fight. So help me maintain, help me maintain. Yeah, I don't wanna live in stress or fear, cause it's getting crazier every day out here. All the love and peace you give to me, I hold so dear. So help me maintain. Help me make